Welcome to Inside New York.
That's a great question. Thank you.
Hi, this is Shaka Khan, and you're watching Inside New York.
Welcome to Inside New York. We are excited to be celebrating the new year with you. And especially since we have a new co-host, Richard Wesley, we're going to be talking about all the most wonderful events, shows, productions, and people, but of course,
absolutely,
right here on Inside New York. And Richard has a special message for you for the new year.
Well, happy new year, everybody. I'm so happy to be here. I'm so happy to be taking part now as a co-host of Inside New York. We're going to be moving in some very interesting directions, as Joan has mentioned to you. One of the big exciting announcements of my book, It's Always Loud in the Balcony, which is on sale now. And we're going to be having a very special event involving Inside New York and U.S. subscribers coming up very, very soon, because we want to try to make that book available to some of you when you subscribe to our show, Inside New York, on YouTube. Now, I want you to look very closely when you view us on YouTube, because just below the image, you'll see a little red box with the word subscribe in it. We want you to click onto that word, subscribe. Join the family here at Inside New York with Joan Allen and yours truly, Richard Wesley.
Yes, because today we're going to talk about self-determination as far as your participation, mm-hmm, with new opportunities for you to bring your arts to us, as well as what is currently out there. We will, mm-hmm, be talking about controversial issues.
Yes, definitely.
Where Richard and I may not agree.
Yeah.
But that makes for exciting programming.
Yes, I think so.
But we definitely going to make it a priority to first bring you the best in theater and the best in film and the best in the arts, all of the art disciplines, so that you know where to go first. And on that note, okay, I'm sure that these last couple of episodes, we have brought you some of the best in theater, mm-hmm, and film, mm-hmm, and art, which will be featured. So we mentioned the last time that we were going to report back to you about the town hall meeting on slave play.
Yes.
We have been kind of, you know, delaying talking about slave play, because I wanted to have an opportunity to see it, and I wanted to bring on the playwright, Jeremy O'Harris, yeah, mm-hmm, so that he would have an opportunity to discuss what many have found to be extremely disturbing and controversial. We thought that waiting, mm-hmm, until the town hall meeting where he was present would be an excellent opportunity to bring to you directly, those who could not be there, what his response was to this controversy, certainly on a small scale. Mm-hmm. However, we did try to reach out to him. We, mm-hmm, reached out to the publicist concerning the play. Mm-hmm. They have not provided press tickets. They have not provided Jeremy an opportunity to speak, even though at that town hall meeting he stated very specifically that he wanted to reach out to the black press. And Richard, you were there,
yes,
when Jeremy talked about,
yes,
the lack of outreach to the black press.
Yes.
What exactly did he say?
Well, he said that there wasn't much of a priority anymore, because as soon as the New York Times gave Slave Play that great review, it's sort of like the impetus for reaching out went away. There was no continued effort as far as reaching out to like the Daily Challenge.
Right.
There was no impetus for that, because we got the New York Times, and now that we have this rave review from the New York Times, we don't really need to put any more effort into that kind of wide-ranging outreach.
But, or specific in this targeted,
yeah,
in this case,
yeah,
the black press.
Yes. Well, Jeremy did not feel that that was,
How did he feel about that?
Well, he wasn't happy about it. He wanted to get as many people coming in as possible, and so that meant reaching out to the black press, where there is deep penetration into the community, a wide circulation, more people would be reading, would be more likely to read black media inside, say, Harlem or the Central Ward of Newark or Bedford-Stuyvesant, places
right,
like that.
Because typically black audiences, unless they
they're not going to be reading the New York Times. They just simply aren't. That's not to say that there aren't a lot of black people who do, but if
right,
you want that massive black audience and everything, then you have to go where that massive black audience is, and that's not always on the arts and leisure pages of the New York Times.
Right.
And that was a big concern of his, and so he was saying that was one of the reasons why he had insisted on the $39 ticket. To come and see the play. That was one of the reasons why he was beating the drum to get a larger, comes to see his show. He didn't want it to be limited just to a narrow spectrum of everyday Broadway goers.
But how are they going to get that ticket if they don't read about it in one of the black newspapers?
Yeah, in the newspapers like the Daily Challenge. Or the Amsterdam News, et cetera, et cetera. No, this idea that there's not a great deal, that the readership isn't large enough, it doesn't hold water when you look at the circulations of those newspapers and just consider, even if just the circulation of those newspapers came, you would have enough people in there to keep the show running for the rest of the year.
And that is one of the areas that we are going to be focusing on in 2020, and I think Richard can talk about that.
Jeremy Harris did express the feeling that he has been very active in trying to convince the marketing people who are behind the production of the play on Broadway to reach out to black media as much as possible. Because so much of the PR engine that drives Broadway is made up of people who are not familiar with the black community, do not engage with it in an ongoing way, they don't always know who to talk to. And so, and
my contention,
yeah,
after being out here.
Yeah, you've been out here for 27 years.
27 years, I'd say 25 years with Broadway specifically,
mm-hmm,
and having to beat down the bushes because there were no forerunners,
mm-hmm,
that I could, hitch a wagon to,
right,
to make a way to cover black theater specifically. And especially on Broadway, and was able to access virtually every August Wilson production on Broadway, as well as many others. You would find me always covering Broadway. But it does seem as though there is no longer the interest to bring in the black press. They're only interested in selling tickets. They're not interested in critical assessment, access, and reviews. And that's why there's a major disconnect with slave play, just in terms of the reaction to it for the masses of the people. And it's a shame, and we are going to publish a piece that addresses this, that the publicist blocked us from even seeing the show. My question is to them, what are you afraid of? That the publicist blocked us giving Jeremy an opportunity to explain his play so that he could reach a larger audience. And that's what was done on a small scale at this town hall meeting. And even though I had heard of very negative comments about this play, I felt as a media representative and a representative to the community that he deserved an opportunity to address mm-hmm. the concerns. And I think that probably if he had had that opportunity all along the way, he might have been able to convince some people that it wasn't necessarily as bad as it had been perceived. So this is denying the artist access to his public. Mm-hmm. And I find that very troubling and disturbing, and we are actively going to advocate against it.
Well, we should, because for one one thing, Jeremy Harris is an incredibly eloquent and able spokesperson for the art that he creates. And what I learned from the opportunity that I had, that I've had to listen to him, is he is very clear and very focused on what it is that he is attempting to do as an artist.
Well, we're not going to talk about that, given that we've been told that they did not want press coverage, and therefore that's why there's no review in the paper. And we will not be talking about what his thoughts are, because if they cannot release him to say in his own words, and the press has been blocked from reporting about it, then I don't. I think we need to move on to those subjects that and art forms in which the black press is and the community is embraced.
Okay.
Because you know, as we said in the very beginning in November, we were running ourselves ragged trying to catch as many plays as possible, and as many art shows, and as many other productions as dance, music, art, theater. We cover it all, and so that's why it's important that we hear from you. We're not going to confine ourselves to what publicists send us. You would never have seen all the iconic individuals through the last 25 years that I've had on this show if I relied solely on publicists.
I'm confident that before the year 2020 is out, we will be speaking with Jeremy Harris, among the other young playwrights that I think are have really established themselves as a mass of new voices that are starting to emerge, and will, over the next, I believe, over the next 10 to 15 years, define and redefine what's happening in black theater. And part of what is happening with Inside New York as we move forward deeper into the 21st century, we're about to go into its third decade, you know, the third decade of this new century. Part of our mandate is going to be to bring those voices out, bring them forward, and give them their moment in the sun. But Having said that,
we're not going to shy away from any controversy. And if for any reason the African American community is upset or disturbed by what is presented, we are going to ask that it be addressed.
Okay,
that's my obligation.
And that, and believe in it. I believe in it, you know, wholeheartedly. You know, especially since I'm a playwright myself,
and right. I know he's a little partial. It's hard to be totally objective.
You know, but
because
you know,
but I respect
that,
his.
Yeah,
that's
a give and take that's going to be between the two of us going forward.
Right.
You know, because we have someone, you know, in Joan, who is someone who maintains a very strict and very defined objectivity, and she is looking at the art through that prism. On the other hand, you have someone like me who is out there writing and everything, and so I will confess to a certain kind of sympathy to artists and people who are working in the creative medium. So this give and take between the artist and the art scholar and the art critic and the art observer, I think, is something that is going to allow us to continuously move the conversation forward about what is happening with the arts and how it's impacting African American culture, not only inside New York, but ultimately inside the entire country and inside the diaspora itself.
Exactly. We're
just a microcosm. A microcosm indeed. Oh. And you're getting just a taste of what we plan to do over the next however long, over the next little bit. This is something, you know, very new and exciting. And even though right now we're mostly talking about the theater, cinema is also a very important, and in the coming months we're going to be addressing as many aspects of that as possible. There's a whole new generation. I talk about the new generation of black playwrights who are emerging. There's a new generation of black filmmakers emerging, and their work and how they view the world and how they view the issues that we have been talking about, you know, certainly over the years. And now you have some young people coming up who are viewing those same issues with a different kind of eye. You know, that's something I always have to confront in the classroom as a professor. I'm teaching students now who have only been born since 1999. They have no living memory of any events that have taken place prior to 1999. All, you know, how do you approach that? It starts to, you know, their vision of the world is shaped in ways that are far different than mine. And so I have to learn sometimes, you know, to listen with a different kind of ear. And in that process, I start seeing things a little differently. But we're going to get into this, I think, like, don't look at me like that.
We're going to get into this as the year goes on.
You just said, Richard Wesley, I'm going to have a bone to pick with you when this show is over.
Oh, no, I'm going to. Thank goodness we're not live, but you never know. In 2020, we just may seek the courage to go live, and there's projects that, you know, that take longer than a weekly program of 28 minutes that I'm looking forward, have been looking forward to working on and pushing it back, So I'm so glad that Richard's here, because I know, I feel confident that if I can't be here because I'm working on a project, that Richard could take my seat and, you know, my baby, so to speak, would be in good, warm hands. So, you know, with love.
Okay.
So, and all I can say to Jeremy is that, Jeremy, if you want to reach the black community, reach out to the black press directly. And you can reach us, you know, whether it's on through our email at insidenewyork@yahoo.com, just like anybody else. If you have a show that you think needs to be seen, heard, but we want to know why. And we may even read that comment on air. So I invite Jeremy and everyone else to reach out to us directly, and we will make sure that you have a seat at the table whenever possible.
Looking forward to it.
And as we mentioned, we will be offering our special viewers and subscribers, first off, an opportunity to be part of a special event for Richard Wesley in celebration of his latest book, It's Always Loud in the Balcony.
That's it.
And you can see it can get a little loud here, too. Yeah. But we like to keep it, you know, lively. And all you have to do is to make sure that when you see this program on TV, or if you see it online at our YouTube channel, that you subscribe, because this will be for our subscribers. Okay? And it's free. So we look forward to seeing you all throughout the year. And again, tell us about your favorite theater or film or dance or musical artist or visual artist that you've seen in 2019. We are compiling our list and would love to hear from you. Email us at insidenewyork@yahoo.com. When Richard comes back from his extended vacation, he's going to be available to chat with you during the program, chat or post on Facebook or Twitter. We'll both make ourselves available so you can respond and ask questions only while the program is airing. If you're seeing it on YouTube, ask your question in the comments. And just go to Inside New York, put in Joan Allen, and you'll be directed if you don't have the link handy. All right, so again, we're wishing you the best for the new year. And Richard, why don't you close?
Keep watching. Keep watching. Keep your ears tuned. Stay tuned. We are going to be blowing up real big in the year 2020. See you soon.
I am so thrilled to have in the studio today an amazing artist, Algernon Miller, whose work can be seen at Wilma Jennings Kankilaba Gallery through January 11th. And it's amazing that I haven't had you on the show until now, except usually with visual artists, I like to go to where their work is. Yes. But since your show is on exhibit and people are going to be looking for places to go and wonderful, you know, things to be involved with and to experience,
I couldn't help but think to reach out to you so that you could talk about your exhibit. And I know that you like to have your work described as interdisciplinary, conceptual, and early Afrofuturist art. That is a mouthful.
Right.
But why don't you start out by letting our viewers know what type of art that is?
Well, interdisciplinary means, actually for me, is that I use a lot of different forms to express myself in. So that includes painting, sculpture, installation, visual, video, sound sculpture, and so a number of different forms. And that's what's in the current show. Yeah. So it's a wonderful survey spanning four decades. And I had a great opportunity to show earlier work mixed with newer work. And all of the above that I mentioned is included in this exhibition, which has really been exciting for me and very, very well received by artists and, you know, just people that are art enthusiasts, you know.
Yes, I had the pleasure of being at the opening and,
That's right.
You had a really awesome amount of people come and it was a wonderful event. And so I really encourage everyone to go and see the work. It is three-dimensional, and then there's an African mystique, I guess, or history and concept as well. Is that tie into the Afrofuturist?
Yes, I would say theme? Probably in one of the first rooms, or actually the multimedia room, mm-hmm. is there are light boxes, and in those light boxes I have pages from books that were like sacred books for me, because those books were portals into greater consciousness and took me to Egypt and Africa and metaphysics and all sorts of, and that represent those important books. And those are called sky words.
Wow.
And I give them that, you know, if we had a picture, you would see that they look like constellations. And there are two groupings. The first one is the very first computer I had, I started to manipulate in Photoshop, and I came up with this way of making words look like stars. And then also in that room is a piece called Naga Baby Quantum Jump. So that has a sound sculpture in it that's related to this piece that has a Naga, which is a Buddha-like child figure that is breaking through this kind of Maya, so to speak. At the same time that things are seem to be getting dark, but there's also lightness and people who are looking for spiritual ways to overcome,